that's what we hope to experience this morning in the time of gathering worship, is that we would be drawn closer in your Christ's presence. So I want to welcome you to worship this morning.
Good morning.
Thank Hope for playing our prayer today. There's a special song, and we're going to find out why in a little bit. So welcome to worship. I'm going to have a couple of announcements. First of all, Vacation Bible School is scheduled for July 26th through the 30th. It'll be in the morning. If some of you think you might like to help with something, just let Mandy know. We'll be meeting together this Wednesday as a planning team. But you know, sometimes some things are all hands out of deck. This is one of those things. So if you'd like to be 5 days, you can just help one day. Anything you can do to help would be appreciated. Camperships are available, so if you have children or grandchildren, neighbor kids who'd like to go to camp, we want to get them registered. So just let us know that too. I want to give you a mask update. All right, so we have been taking baby steps as we open up. All right, and so some of you would have received the newsletter and online in the mail. But we're going to go with CDC guidelines, and so this is what we're asking: is if you have been vaccinated, you no longer have to wear a mask, unless you wish to. That's okay too. If you haven't been vaccinated, we're going to ask that you continue to mask up. So we just want to put that up to you. We're going to continue to social distance for a little while. Hopefully by the end of the summer. Later in the summer, we'll just open things up. And then also, that last night was the first night for our Saturday service. I know we were competing with the races out at the fairgrounds last night. But just know that if you're not able to come on Sunday morning, then maybe Saturday at 5 o'clock might work for you. So we just want to make sure that you're aware of that and you know that. All right, friends, let's open in prayer. Heavenly Father, we're grateful for the gift and the blessing of this beautiful day to come together, fellowship with one another, Lord, and more importantly, to fellowship with you. We just pray, Lord, for a fresh outpouring of your Holy Spirit on us today as we begin our time of worship, that you would use this time to get our attention, to change us, so that we might more fully look like your Son, Jesus Christ. It's in his name that we pray. Amen.
For the call to worship and the opening song, and please respond with those in bold prayer. We gather to give thanks to you, O Lord, with all our heart.
We will sing your praises before all creation and rejoice in your steadfast love.
You have created us, O Lord, and made us for yourself.
In you we become everything you have made us to be.
This morning's opening hymn is, Lord, I lift your name on
high.
I'm so glad you
bring sorrow to God's Holy Spirit by the way you live. Remember, he has identified you as his own, guaranteeing that you will be saved on the day of redemption. Get rid of all bitterness, rage, anger, harsh words, and slander, as well as all kinds of evil behavior. Instead, be kind to each other, tender-hearted, forgiving one another, just as God through Christ has forgiven you. And from Luke chapter 10, verses 25 through 28. One day, an expert in religious law stood up to test Jesus by asking him this question: "Teacher, what should I do to inherit eternal life?" Jesus replied, "What does the law of Moses say? How do you read it?" The man answered, "You must love the Lord your God with all your heart, all your soul, all your strength, and all your mind, and love your neighbor as yourself." "Right," Jesus told him, "do this, and you will live."
We have some special music. Hope is going to sing for us a song called "It's Incredible."
Incredible. Mr. Rogers' Neighborhood.
Today we're starting a new sermon series called Faith in Film. Now, there are times, we know that movies can sometimes help us see things in ourselves, to learn things about ourselves. Maybe help us see the places where we're doing great, maybe even the places where we need to grow. So for the next 4 or 5 weeks, we'll be using movies to see what messages we can take away. So as you might have guessed from the short intro, this week's film is A Beautiful Day in the Neighborhood.
Oops.
I messed that up. Presbyterian minister. And so his ministry was to go on TV. this program for children, the messages for children, messages about being kind, about accepting other people, about sharing feelings, about loving who you are. Those are the messages of his program. So it's not surprising that his work is grounded in Scripture. He's a Presbyterian pastor, so you know it's not surprising to us that he would kind of have a faith perspective, although the film doesn't really quote the Bible. There's only one place where the reading Scripture was even referenced. But the lessons, I think, of the Scriptures are obvious in this film. I want to look back at the passages that we read. The first one was from Paul's letter to the church in Ephesus. And so he's writing this from a Roman prison, and he writes to them about how we are to treat one another. How they're to treat one another. And by extension, how we're to treat one another. And he writes this to encourage them. He said, let everything you say be good and helpful, so that your words will be an encouragement to those who hear them. Get rid of all the bitterness and rage and anger and harsh words and slander, as well as all types of evil behavior. Instead, be kind to each other, tenderhearted, forgiving one another, just as God through Christ has forgiven you. In other words, get rid of all the ugliness. If you look around us today, there's a lot of ugliness. And why is it, the answer, why would you do that? Because we have received kindness and forgiveness from God. So we ought to extend it to others. You know, in ethic life, we sometimes want to hold on to our grudges, our anger, our resentments. But what we hear over and over in the Scriptures is that as Christians, we're called to a higher standard, a different way of relating to the world around us, a different way of relating to one another. I would love to hear an amen on that.
Amen.
Yeah, we're called to be different. We're called to a different standard, and that's Paul's point. In Christ, we aren't who we used to be. We're called to be different. We're called to show kindness toward others, to show love and respect and civility. And then in the verses from Luke 10, Jesus is being challenged by an expert in the law, a man who asks the question, and I want us to be clear about this. He's not asking that question because he's curious. Teacher wants the answer to this. That's not why he's asking the question. He's asking the question because he really wants to trip Jesus up. He wants to discredit him. And so he asks the question. He says, what's the way to eternal life? And Jesus, like many good teachers, he doesn't give the answer. Instead, he turns the question back to the one asking, well, what do you think? How do you read it? Well, man says, we're supposed to love the Lord our God with all our hearts and soul and strength and mind and love our neighbor as ourselves. Jesus says, well done. That's right. If you do those things, then you will live. Now, if we were to read the rest of the chapter, we would know that this man asks a follow-up question of Jesus. He says, well, who exactly is my neighbor? In other words, what are the boundaries that loving is supposed to take place within? Who are my neighbors? Who exactly am I supposed to love? Now, again, it's meant to put Jesus on the spot. But Jesus answers with the story of the Good Samaritan. If you remember, read the rest of that chapter, you remember, a man is beaten, he's left on the side of the road to die. Two men, God-fearing men, we might say church folk, they see him there, but they pass by on the other side and keep walking. And then a third man comes. Now, he happens to be a Samaritan. He's part of a group that the Jewish people hate. Well, they don't like each other, right? But this man is the one who stops. And he gives aid to the man, and he takes the man to a safe place so that he can heal and he can get stronger. He needs help. And, of course, the point of Jesus' story, the point of this story is that there aren't any limits to loving your neighbor. Our neighbors are all around us. And we're called to love all of them. The people we know, the people we don't know, the people we agree with, the people we don't agree with, the people we love and people we don't love. Our people who look like us, and talk like us, and think like us, the people who don't. The point of the story is that they're all to be our neighbors. And as Christ's followers, God expects us to love everybody, to show kindness and compassion to everyone. I came across a billboard. It's been a while now. Maybe some of you have seen these. Someone put up these billboards from God. And one of them said this. It says, that love thy neighbor thing. I meant that. That love thy neighbor thing. I meant that. Decided by God. And God does mean for us to love our neighbors. And who are our neighbors? Everyone. Now, we all know that we're commanded to love God above everything else, and to love our neighbors the same way that we love ourselves. The problem is not in the understanding or the hearing. The problem is in our doing. And we don't always get it right. I came across this story recently. It was about an American mountain climbing team. This story, this is from May of 2006. They were climbing Mount Everest. And the team, they were doing well. They were getting close to the top, within 1,000 feet of the top. And someone told me in the Scranton service that it's 2,500 feet or so. That's the last, from the top, that's the last base camp. So people who were past that, they're pretty much on their own, right? But what this team does is they abandon their climb to rescue this Australian climber named Lincoln Hall. They're only 1,000 feet from the summit, from their goal. So it seems that Hall had collapsed near the summit due to the altitude, due to the lack of oxygen. It's very dangerous up there near the top. And the team that he was with, they tried to help him, but they decided in the end to abandon him, which they did. And so as they passed the American team on the way down, they told him about Hall. They said that he was dead, that Hall was dead. But the next morning, the Americans continued to the summit. They found him sitting in the snow. He was disoriented. He was very much alive. Then they did something that was truly amazing. They forgot about their own climb, their own goal to reach the summit of Everest. Remember, they're very close to the summit. And in order to try and save Paul's life, which they do, they save his life. And to see how really amazing this is, apparently 10 days earlier, another climber had gotten into trouble, and he died. You see, it seems that 40 people, 40 other climbers had walked by him. They didn't stop him. They didn't make an attempt to save him. So he wasn't rescued. He died. Kind of like the story of the Good Samaritan, isn't it? So it isn't that we don't know the right thing to do. Most often we do. It's just that we choose not to do the right thing, or even where sometimes we make a point of doing the wrong thing. Maybe even being intentionally unkind or unforgiving. You know, when I read social media posts and I listen to news programs, and I listen to the way that people talk to one another, or the way that people talk about one another. How people try to stir the pot about other people. You know, it's clear that we've forgotten what kindness looks like. We've forgotten how to love our neighbor, how to be patient with one another. We've gotten ourselves turned around and going in the wrong direction. And that was the case with Lloyd Vogel. He was negative, and he was cynical, and he was unkind, and he was unforgiving. And I look around me, and in a lot of ways, in our society, we could be that way too. I even think that he used his job as an investigative reporter in order to shield himself. He could be unkind to people. He could ask tough questions to people. And he could write these scathing articles, awful things about people, digging into bottom dirt. When Lloyd's wife, Andrea, heard that he was assigned to interview Mr. Rogers, she knew that he was tough. But she told him that, she said, don't ruin my childhood. You're going to interview Mr. Rock, don't ruin my childhood. To her, he was a hero. She didn't want her husband rocking it for her. But you know, when Lloyd met Fred Rogers, things began to change. His worldview changed. His feelings toward his father changed. How he saw himself as a husband and a father to his wife and his infant son, they changed too. See, because in Mr. Rogers, he met a man who walked the talk. You know, so often we see people on TV and they play a role, don't they? And it's just, Tom Hanks played Mr. Rogers, it was just a role. But the real Fred Rogers was the authentic person. Who you saw on television was who he really was. It wasn't just a persona, an act. He was genuinely interested in people. He took time to be with people. He took time to listen to stories. He wrote letters of encouragement to simply love and accept people for who they were. He was a genuine person. See, Lloyd saw that in him. You know, despite Lloyd's best attempts to probe, you know, to dig up the dirt, you know, Fred Rogers, you know, he was trying to get Fred to say, oh, aren't you burdened by all the problems that people come to you with? That must be a burden. We're going to say that that's a burden to you. You know, Fred Rogers would say, Mr. Rogers would say, aren't they courageous in wanting to share their difficulties with me? Aren't they courageous? He wouldn't have anything up. He reframed everything the Lord tried to dig up on him. But, you know, in the end, it made a difference in Lloyd's life because it helped him to reconcile with his dad. And all those angry feelings, he emerged from that relationship with his father. So it helped him to reconcile and to be there for his dad when his dad passed away. So what are the things that we take away here from this film? The first, the obvious, is that we have a responsibility to one another, to see others as neighbors, to treat people with kindness and with respect. And part of that involves listening. It involves listening. But we don't have to agree with people. But we don't have to demonize people we don't agree with. Because maybe that's why you see a lot of them today. People don't agree with one another, so they must be the enemy. And we have people telling us, well, if they don't agree with you, if they think differently than you, then they must be the enemy. And so we begin to see ourselves as enemies. And we don't listen to one another with an understanding, with an ear toward understanding. So Mr. Rogers, he did that. He took time to really hear what was on Lloyd's heart, to see past the hurt that caused him to see the world the way that he did. And the key here, I think, is in the listening. We don't listen today. Either we shut people out entirely, or we don't listen because we're more interested in telling them what we think and why they're wrong, or we judge them first, and we never get around to the listening part. So here's true confession. There's true confession. I sometimes suffer from that affliction. I don't always listen as well as I should. I don't always see past the words to really listen to the other person's heart. I hear the words, but I don't bother to look deeper to see what's really going on in this person's life. I suspect I'm not the only one. Maybe I am. I suspect not. But there are others that also can work on listening skills. So first we need to love others, and we need to listen with our hearts to help others know that they've been heard, that they're cared for. But here's the second thing. You know, we might be inclined to see Mr. Rogers as somehow different. Maybe even saintly, right? Nobody could be the way that he is unless they were extra special, and, you know, saints. You know, but here's what Mr. Rogers' wife, Joanne, has to say. When Lloyd asks, you know, what is it like to be married to a living saint? Let's watch this clip.
I call this one the handshake and nod.
Let's go, Sam.
When we stole Bill from the governor's office 14 years ago, you got a chance to know him yet?
Hello, Bill. Big fan.
He is very protective of Raj.
You call him Raj?
We don't call him Mr. Rogers at home, dear. Dylan Rogers.
Oh, nice to meet you.
He was well, dear.
So, how does it feel to be married to a living saint?
Yeah, I'm not fond of that term. And if you think of him as a saint, then his way of being is unattainable. And he works at it all the time. It's a practice. He's not a perfect person. He has a temper. He chooses how he responds to that anger.
I'm just taking a lot of effort.
No. I mean, he does things every day that help to ground him. Reads scripture, swims laps, prays for people by name, writes letters, hundreds of them. He's been doing that since I met him.
Did you catch that? He's not a saint. He's not perfect, but he works at it. He works at it. You know, I think that that's hopeful. You know, Jesus said the greatest commandment is to love God and to love our neighbor as we love ourselves. And he commands us to do the same. But he wouldn't command us to do something that was unattainable, something that was impossible for us to do. Yes, we might need the help of the Holy Spirit. We might have to fall back in our relationship with Jesus, but we are capable of loving our neighbor. But we might have to work at it. But she shares that her husband, he does things every day to ground him. He reads scripture, swims laps, he prays for people by name, he writes letters of encouragement. What this tells us is that he had disciplines that he practiced to help him to control those negative feelings and to relate to people as neighbors with kindness and compassion and love and patience and hope. And so the question for us, as we look at this clip, is what grounds us in Christ's love? What disciplines do we have that help us to walk the talk and to grow as disciples of Jesus? What disciplines? What grounds you? You've heard me say this before, you know, things about reading scripture and praying. You know, she lists some other things that we do to stay grounded. And so what do we do? That's important. It's important to have those disciplines. Here's the last thing that I want to lift up. As I was writing this sermon, it occurred to me that as a parent, and now as a grandparent, I see the world and relate to the world. And how I do that, it affects them, influences them. How I view my neighbors affects my kids and my grandkids. How I respond to things matters. Now, if you've got grandkids or kids, you know, you realize that how you respond to other people, how you show kindness to other people, or compassion, or patience to other people, they see that. Kids learn what they see in their homes. They learn what they're taught. And so if you're negative, then negativity begets negativity. If you're cynical, then cynicism begets cynicism. If you judge other people, then that's what they're going to see. Hatred begets hatred. But I think the opposite is also true. Positivity begets positivity. Hopefulness begets hopefulness. Kindness begets kindness. Love begets love. You know, for Fred Rogers, his legacy in his work with children was one of kindness and compassion and love and hope and patience and all of those good things. Positivity. So the question for us is, what kind of legacy will we leave? When we talk about, you know, kids, our own kids, our grandkids, even kids in the church, you know, if we interact with them in a negative way, there's more negativity, cynicism, dislike, impatience. It matters. So the question is, what kind of legacy will we leave? You know, how can we teach those we influence what it means to, and you can use this phrase again, walk the talk and be a good neighbor to others. So what now? What do we do with this? First of all, we need to find ways to ground ourselves in faith. You know, like Fred Rogers, we can read scripture, we can pray for others. We can even pray for the people who love us the wrong way or people that we don't agree with. Maybe for you, it's spending time in nature, you know, appreciating what God has created, and sensing God's presence with you that helps to ground you. So that if you have these negative feelings or these feelings of judgment toward others, you can remind yourself, that's not God's way. I'm called to a different standard, a higher standard. So what grounds you? Find those things that ground you. Maybe you're grounded in your work. Or music, whatever it is. The other thing is we can be intentional and neighborly to others. Because how we respond to others, how we respond to the needs of others, let me tell you a secret, it's a choice. It's a choice. And how we use our words. We can use our words to hurt others as weapons. We can use our words in kindness to show God's love to others. Just know it's a choice. Lloyd figured that out. It's a choice. I was thinking about this idea of random acts of kindness. You're doing something unexpected to brighten someone else's day. Now, last week, Rich and I had two great experiences within about an hour. It was really kind of an amazing thing. We went to La Terraza for lunch, and you know, we waited for the waiter to bring us the bill. He said that we were waiting a long time. The finally, he said, bring the bill. He said, oh, someone else has already paid for your lunch. Wow. We didn't expect that. But what a wonderful blessing. Then we went over to the golf course. We were going to play around with golf, and we got the stuff out of the car, and someone from the church happened to be sitting there on the patio. He just finished his round, and he said, hey, if you want to use my golf cart, it's parked over there. You're welcome to use my golf cart. Then you won't have to pay for it. Wow. Two acts of kindness in the same day. What a blessing. What a blessing. You know, unexpected and appreciated. Other things that you can do. You write a thank you note to the people in your life who've made a difference. Maybe it's a parent, or a teacher, or a coach. Maybe it's a child or a grandchild. Write a thank you note. You'll leave encouraging notes for others to find. You know, maybe you know, if you like your doctor does a good job, leave a note. They sent flowers to my doctor one time. She's the one who maybe had the test that found the cancer. If she hadn't maybe had the test about the cancer, I might not be here. Not at all. We'll send some flowers. But do something. Do something to show people that you appreciate it. You know, post a positive review for a local business. You know, if you ever go on reviews, a lot of times when people post a negative, they're more than willing to jump right on there and post the negative stuff. But what about going on and posting something positive? We can always find positive things. We can be kind just as easy as we can be unkind. You know, offer someone a compliment today. We've got this little 24/7 food box out here, you know, on the side of the church. It's just available for people whenever they need a few things to stop in and pick up a few things. You know, when you go to the grocery store, maybe make a point of stopping by there and putting a few things in there. It's a kindness. You know, before you get in your car, check your road rage at the door, the car door. Practice being neighborly on the road, even when you're in a hurry. Take time to visit with someone in the nursing home. You know, still a little bit difficult, you know, getting in and out of there, but you know, call people. We visit on the phone if that's easier. We have some new families in the community. Take time to go and meet them. And welcome them. You know, it's hard to move to a small town where everybody else knows everybody else. I've been here 7 years, and I still, the people talk about people, say, I don't think I know them. And so it's hard to fit in. It's hard to find your place. Make an anonymous donation to a charity of your choice. Host a neighborhood gathering. We're starting to, more people are vaccinated. We're starting to come out of this thing. You know, maybe you're ready to host a neighborhood kind of gathering. Invite a neighbor or a friend to see a beautiful day in the neighborhood. You know, dial it up on Netflix or Prime and invite some folks over to watch. Maybe you can think of some other things to show kindness to others. So ask yourself, you know, what one thing can you do this week to bless somebody else? Show them that you care, that you appreciate them. Friends, you know, we can get lost in the questions and the discussions and the debates over who qualifies as our neighbor. We can debate about what it means to love our neighbor. But in the end, it's really not that hard to figure out. Look around you. These are your neighbors. Everybody that you meet in the street as you leave this place, today and the week going forward, they're your neighbor. They're the people that God has put in your path. Right? So we have a choice. To show kindness. I think it will be a beautiful day in the neighborhood when we have a heart for God and for God's people. You don't have to be saved. not any Mother Teresa. We just have to keep our eyes open, our ears open, our hearts open to God's nudges. We need to stay grounded in our faith, and we need to make the choice to be neighborly. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, you have shown kindness to us. You have forgiven us. When we don't deserve it, yet it's there. You have commanded us to love our neighbor. And so, Lord, may your Spirit help us to do that. Help us to make the right choices as it relates to other people. We don't have to judge first, Lord, but we can be kind. We pray this in Christ's name. Amen. We would invite you to stand as you're able. And we're going to sing 2167 in Black Hymn, More Like You.
Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna.
are you, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. The night in which Jesus gave himself up for us, he took the bread. He gave thanks. He broke it. He gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat, this is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Then when the supper was over, he took the cup. He gave thanks. And he gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." And so in remembrance of these, your mighty acts of Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice, in union with Christ offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Let us pray. Lord, pour out your Holy Spirit in us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and cup. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and when in ministry to all the world until Christ comes in final victory and we feast in his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit in your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. As the body of Christ broken for you. I invite you to take the top off of the bread. And let's share Christ's body together. Christ's blood, the cup of salvation, pour out for you. I invite you to take the top off of the juice. Let's share Christ's blood together. Whatever it is, Lord, see the hurt of our neighbors, the struggles of our neighbors, and to be neighborly, not to judge, but just to love in the way that you call us to love our neighbors as we love ourselves. Lord, we give you thanks for this church. You call us to be neighbors to everyone in this community and beyond it, to be instruments of your love, to show kindness and compassion, to share good news of forgiveness. So Lord, help us to do that more and more, to be known as the church that loves others, the neighborly church. And Lord, we give you thanks for Jesus Christ, who taught us what it is to love sacrificially and unconditionally. Hear us together, we pray the prayer Jesus taught his disciples to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. We invite you to stand and to sing our praise song, Shalom to you. Now, Shalom is the Jewish word for peace, but it's more than just an absence of chaos or conflict. It's to bless someone, their entire person, the blessing of God, well-being. So let's sing Shalom to you. Go in peace and be the church. All God's people say, amen. Amen.